brief daily sessions, which is what we've been talking about. So binge writers have this many pages written per week, this many hours of writing per week, this many manuscripts submitted, and this many manuscripts accepted. And then look at this part of the chart. Brief daily session writers, right? So people who are writing one unit a day, you know, one unit a day for 5 days a week. They have this many pages per week, this many hours, this many papers submitted, and this many accepted. And this actually tracks my experience of things. That, and I can say this about my own life. There are times in my life where I behave like a romantic, right? There are times where I'm only able to binge write, and I'm only able to think about writing if I have a huge amount of time. And those times are the times in my life where I get very little written and where I'm not submitting and publishing very much. And the times in my life where I'm writing at least one unit a day and I'm just doing it steadily are the times where I get tremendous amounts done. So I really think that this is something that I can just wholeheartedly recommend to you. And it's the beauty of it is that success is just, did you do a unit today? It's not were you brilliant? It's not did you finish the thing? All it is did you just do, did you show up to work and do a unit uninterrupted? Yay. Like, and that's the end of it. And then the outcome is that. Yeah.
As someone who has a hard time starting to write when it feels directionless, to say that you're going to tell yourself to write a unit, take one unit, just one, every day and write, and be okay with it, might not be, that it could just be thrown out. I've started my writing process for my lit review, and I'm struggling with the fact that I'm already realizing that there might be pages that I have to just throw out, and then just.
Yeah.
I guess I'm just overall anxious about wasting time writing something that's not going to give me anything.
Good. So, and this is, a lot of people spoke to this feeling of like, how should I think about having, feeling like everything that I write is really precious. So I think a way to think about that quality is to say, the writing is a process, not a product. And to actually just believe that, so that anytime you're writing, you're honing your skills, you're working through your thoughts, you're doing something. And that the outcome of that, on some level, you have to just trust that there's gonna be something arising from the process that you can rely on. So it is about being less precious with our words, and that's about being less of a perfectionist.
Okay.
Yeah, so just having the sense that not everything you write has to be like the golden, you know, voiced, perfect thing. And that goes both ways, that then you're allowed to edit because it might not be perfect. And this is that like sense of it being serious but an experiment.
Yeah.
So I wanted to skip ahead a little bit to some of the ways that this can work. Yes. Okay.
So I'm from the mechanical department, and for me, like right now, I'm creating my experimental setup.
Yeah.
And I help, for instance, to buy some equipment, right?
Yeah.
Where I have to drive and get this equipment. Or something I'm receiving and I'm finding its wrong size.
Right.
So sometimes units, they are not perfect.
Yeah.
Like those 45 minutes, it could be like 20 minutes of driving there. And would you count, is it a part of the unit?
No.
So just the moment when I'm getting my device.
So it's doing the experimental design counts as a unit. Figuring out why it's not the correct size, that will count as a unit. Driving to get the equipment doesn't count as a unit. So anytime that you're working on the work, that's going to count.
Okay, and when you're improving yourself, right? Making yourself more efficient. For instance, this session.
Yeah.
Is it a unit for me right now or no?
I don't think this is a unit.
Okay.
Does it feel like a unit?
I don't know. I'm concentrated and focused.
Okay. We have been doing units, right? I don't know if you've noticed, we've been taking breaks, 45-minute breaks, basically. So it's definitely the case that you can be like, I'm doing a unit of this. But in terms of thinking about your thesis, it's work that produces that, right? So whatever falls into that category, which is why it's going to be writing, it's going to be reading, it could be thinking, it's going to be some of the things that I'm going to talk about right this minute. So the thing that I want you to do, especially if you have this feeling about writing that you're describing, is to start to understand that writing is a whole lot of things that are not encompassed by the moment that you're sitting down at the computer. So we're going to include pre-writing and writing and revision all as writing. So pre-writing can include, has everyone in the room heard of or done free writing? Has anyone not and needs that explained? Okay, so free writing is a kind of writing that recognizes that the writer, the creative force, is not necessarily helped by the person that's commenting on the writing, right? So the editor says, that was a stupid way to say that. I think that needs to be a comma instead of a semicolon, right? So free writing is a way to take the editor and say, you are so important and useful. Thank you so much for all your valuable, valuable critical commentary. Could you just wait over here for a minute, and then I'll have some more things for you to comment on in a little bit. And then the editor's like, oh good, I'll wait over here. So free writing is that you, often it helps to do this by hand. My sister, who is a novelist, has done a lot of her writing by hand with her wrong hand, which does something interesting also to your brain. So it's interesting to do it by hand, different haptic situation. If you're typing on a laptop, you can put a piece of paper in front of the screen. If you're typing on a desktop, you can turn the screen off. You have the whatever word processing program you're using open. And you just write without stopping or correcting or commenting for a set period of time, usually 10 or 15 minutes. You can have this be very loose. You can just write about nothing in particular. Or you can write about a set thing. And so usually it'll be like, if you're working on your OGS and you were free writing for it, you would open your word processing program, turn your screen off or cover it, or open the notebook. And then you would say, my project is about, my project is about, my project is important because, and you come back to the same thing over and over again. And then you start popping up different things because you're just writing and you're not allowing yourself to go back and read and edit. And at the end of a free writing session, you read with a sense of generosity and care what you've written and look at what places you really said the thing that you meant to say. So free writing can be seeds, and then you can just copy it and paste it into your real document, those phrases or the whole thing, the places where you were really saying. And what you discover when you start doing free writing is that in 10 minutes, you can very easily type 350 words with no problem at all. And it can be on your topic. So it gives you a sort of seed to work from. And it also just kind of loosens you up and lets there be this space where the editor's like, I'm just going to let you do your work there for a minute, okay? You know? And you're like, thanks, I'm good. And then later, you bring the editor in to comment and refine. Yeah, Sam?
I think sometimes what I experience, what my problem is that I don't, maybe it's a trust thing, I don't trust my voice, and then I am like constantly sourcing and mining.
I do the same thing.
Yeah, like help in mobilizing what I really want to say.
Yep.
I can't just say it in a free written, because perhaps the word changes things.
This is the beauty of free writing, though, that you can't stop. You're not allowed to stop. You just keep typing. So if the next thing that you're typing is, I can't believe how stupid I sound, this is really awful, what would Alexis say? She would tell me not to tell me that myself that I'm stupid. Okay, what was I talking about? Oh, this is what my project is on. Right? Then that all goes in there. So it's just also like, it's actually this kind of interesting form of mindfulness that you're tuning into what you're talking through and just making a trace of that. Because usually people are great at actually talking about what they're thinking about and have a much harder time than writing that down with a kind of fluidity and ease. But it's not necessary that we be so constrained all the time with ourselves.
I found also, just because I have a tape recorder for field work, but sometimes the writing process is kind of hindering. So like just to vocally, because just having conversations with people too, sometimes you're like, that actually made more sense than what I was trying to write it, so.
Yeah, so the next part, which I've put as emailing/depriming, is another technology that's like free writing, but different. So there's lots of different modalities where, has everyone heard of priming or depriming? So priming is a way that you set up your mind to think about the next thing that's going to happen. And so advertising primes us to think that we really need something. Turns out also that when we open a program on our computer that is causes us to feel blocked, nervous, self-critical, that we actually go into that space. So often this program is Microsoft Word. So if we open a different program that we don't feel that way in, so it used to be that like people would use LiveJournal, and they would be able to just like open LiveJournal and just type what they're thinking about, or send an email. Like I often used to send emails to my friend Sumner, just being like, hey, I'm working on my thesis. This is the thing that I don't understand how to say. I think what I'm trying to talk about is this. So it turns out that when you're in any of these other, when you're in Tumblr, right, when you're in an email program, you might, any place where you know you write with fluidity and ease can be a really good way to generate the material that later you can edit. Another mode is to talk into your phone, right, to just like talk through some things. Another thing to do, especially since a lot of people are doing interviews for their project, is to say, will you interview me about what I'm talking about? Another thing is that it's good to have conversations with your supervisor that you record. So you can ask your supervisor, can I come and talk to you about my project? I'd like to record our conversation. Is that okay? Because a lot of the time when you're in the middle of a conversation, you don't actually remember what you're saying. And sometimes your supervisor will say useful things, and you don't even notice. You know, maybe they never say anything useful, but sometimes they might. So it's okay to record that. And then there's various kinds of voice recognition software that you can, you know, run things through if you want to get a rough and ready transcript. Another one is note carding. And I'm going to talk about note carding and color coding and remapping together. So this is after you've produced something and you feel like, I don't even understand how to think about this text that I've produced. So, there are several ways to do this. So note cards, little 3x5 cards. You have this piece of work that you're working on. I suggest printing out your stuff, even though it's evil to cut down trees. The computer is a tool for production, not organization, and we need to textualize and make lateral the things that we're working on. So if you're doing this kind of work, you go through the piece and write down every time you're making a new point or a new move in the argument or a claim on a separate note card. A way to do this also is to read the paper backwards. So you start with the last paragraph and write down what that paragraph is claiming or doing. What this does is it unlinks your brain, which knows what you meant to say, from what you actually said, right? So you want to disrupt your brain's capacity to fill in the gaps, because bringing your reader along to show what you're saying is your job as a writer. And that can be really hard to do if you know what you meant to say. So reading the paper backwards and writing down each move in the argument on note cards can be very helpful for making the structure of the thing visible. Then you take all the note cards and you put them up on a wall so you can see them all. What's this chapter doing? And you look at them. And another possibility is color coding. So you take crayons or colored pencils or markers, and you're like, okay, this is the main thing that this note card is doing. So like, I'm writing this paper right now about frogs and toxicity and gender and disability and pollution. And so there's different parts where it's like, here's where gender is really being talked about, right? Here's where a particular version of disability coming out of toxic presence is happening, right? So those can have different colors. And when you're looking at it all taped up on a wall, you get a really different feeling for what the piece of writing is doing. So it can really ground and allow you to see like, oh, right now it's organized like this, but obviously it needs to actually totally be organized in a completely different way. And maybe the thing that I thought I was doing, this piece of writing, is not the thing that I'm doing at all. So that's back outlining, with combined with note carding and color coding. So the general thing here is that at some point you're going to give this piece of writing to someone for their feedback. And the orientation then is going to be that that also is part of the writing process. So remember that thing about locating the writing outside of you, right? So then getting feedback is part of the process of writing. And revising is part of the process of writing. So in the work of revising, the view is that you are taking whatever comes to you, and you're responding to it, and you're also holding your ground. So you're recognizing that your readers, especially your readers who have power, might have useful things to say. There might be some things that you have to do in order to get it through. But they might not also know everything that you're trying to say. And so standing your ground means telling them, no, I think that that wasn't what I meant to say there, or you misunderstood what I was saying. How about if I try it this way? So that also can be part of the writing and revision process. So the way to do that is through this thing that I'm going to recommend as the memo. And I recommend that you use this with peers when you ask your comrades to edit or work on things. But I'm going to be specifically talking about this as a way to manage up for your committee and your supervisor. So the view here is that faculty feedback we can relate to as a valuable commodity. And something that we want to use wisely and well. We can also know that faculty in general are tired, overworked, and self-involved, and not actually really the best readers in general. I think I can say this about my colleagues with and myself with love and understanding and recognition that like it's not actually great to have the situation where you as writers are really dependent on us as readers, because it's actually like everyone's doing too much, right? So we have to manage that situation. And one thing that you don't want is to give your committee member, your supervisor, a piece of writing where you say, here's some writing, let me know what you think. Because inevitably the faculty is just gonna be like a donkey that's just kind of like, I like, you know, roses. Why aren't there more roses, right? And just kind of like randomly walking through the field of your paper, eating some of it and totally ignoring other parts of it. Or like that video that we were talking about the that was the golden retriever who totally fails the agility test. Have you seen this video? Look it up, golden retriever totally fails the agility test. The agility test is just can the dog come to the dog's owner through a pathway of really enticing and interesting toys and treats. And the golden retriever is like, I see you over there, but I'm over here. I'm just going to like eat the thing and then, oh, look at this interesting toy, you know. That's what supervisors are like. We enter your chapter, your thesis, and we're just kind of like, I am interested in the toys and the treats. And those toys and treats are just my definition of toys and treats, which totally could be completely different than what you're actually trying to do and what you need feedback on. So, the memo frames and invites the supervisor to give a particular kind of feedback, which we can here call useful feedback. So in order to prime that, this is what I recommend. Even though probably you call your supervisor by their first name, in this case, you're going to write a memo, or you could write a memo, that says, Dear Doctor. So like, Sarah is my student. If she writes to me, Dear Dr. Shotwell, it's a little shocking. And the particular way that it's shocking is that it's hailing me into my role. So I'm not responding to her as like Alexis to Sarah, right? I'm responding to her in my role as her supervisor. So actually being slightly more formal cues that, right? Like this is a formal relationship that you have an obligation to me to respond in a timely way. Then you say, here is. And what you're saying there is very specific. Here is 20 pages of a second draft that is attempting to make this argument. You have seen two other drafts of this, right? You have seen another draft of this. At this stage, I am looking for broad level feedback on whether this argument works. Or this is the fourth draft. This is a near final draft, right? At this stage, I am primarily looking for sentence and small idea level feedback. Right? Do you see how those are totally different things to ask for? If you don't say, I'm looking for broad feedback about the overall argument, your supervisor might end up going in and giving you like super nitpicky comments on every sentence. And if you're at a stage of drafting where you're just trying to try things out, having this like, I do not believe that that is really what Mel Chen thinks when they're saying this, is going to just totally shut you down, right? So if you tell your supervisor that that's not the kind of feedback you want, you have a better chance of not getting that kind of super nitpicky, shutting down-y kind of feedback. So where do they fit into the whole project, right? This is chapter 5 of 6. I'm referring you back to the table of contents that we generated, right? So especially if you're the kind of person that isn't in touch with your supervisor for a long time, it's useful to just remind them what the scope of the whole project is. Then you want to be able to say what the core argument is. So on the handout, the way that I framed this is, at the end of this, I want my reader to believe or understand. So this is a really useful thing for you just to be able to do, to say what your core thing is that this piece of writing is trying to do. So there's a lot of different phrases. The one that I usually use is, I want my reader to believe and understand whatever. So that you want to say to the supervisor, this is what I believe I'm doing. And then they can say, oh no, I don't think you're actually doing that. But if you never say that, they'll respond to some other random thing that they think you're doing. So then it's useful to ask for specific feedback. So I would like feedback on, does the overall arc of this argument work well? Am I doing an appropriate use of Haraway here? Right? So three things that you want them to read for. This also is a way for you to track what feedback you've given. So the next draft, as you'll see, I've made a more explicit engagement with that argument that you asked me to make last time. Because the other thing that tends to happen sometimes is that supervisors are like, they'll tell you to do something and then later they'll tell you to do the other thing. So if you can remind them that the reason you did this thing was because they told you to do that thing, then that's useful. Yeah? Then you have to get used to the moment at which you say, is this something that you feel you can sign off on? So you're going to say that a lot of different times. And this is what we think of as like landing the plane. Is this something that you feel is ready to send out to the rest of the committee? Do you feel ready to send this to the external examiner? Because unless you actually say those words to your supervisor, they may just continue to give you feedback. Because it could always get better, right? But at a certain point, they're probably not going to say, I think it's great, I think it's done. They might. People are different. But you want to have a tickle for them to have the opportunity to be like, yeah, I could sign off on that. So is everyone clear on the memo? Okay. So then what I'd like us to do is, really, really quickly, and it does not need to be faster than this, to just do a couple of things. So have a piece of paper or a document, and I'd like you to come up with a working title for your thesis. So even if you're like in your first year of your MA, and you don't know what you're doing entirely, you have some idea. So I don't need you to have the definitive working title. I just need you to have a working title. You have 30 seconds. Okay, who doesn't have one? Sarah, what's your thesis about?
Gender identities, public transportation.
So your thesis title is going to be, for right now, Get on the Bus, Gender and Identity in Public Transportation.
Right.
Write it down. Who else doesn't have one yet? Allison, what's yours?
I'm not doing my thesis right now, so...
That's okay.
Paper for your class.
A genealogy of our human and animal relations.
Good. Did anyone else not have one? Is anyone else not have one but not admitting it because they don't want me to give them a title called Get on the Bus?
I have one, I just can't find it.
Well, what is it?
I've had one for a long time.
You have to know what it is.
I know.
What's your thesis about?
Identity and people sexually offended. So it's something like listening to their voices or something that is sexually offended, blah, blah, blah.
So I think, if I can say, find a way to have that be something that's closer to the tip of your tongue.
Yeah, I know.
Okay, but everyone else feels like they got that? So you don't have to have the perfect title. It just has to be a title, but it needs to be something that you can come to your mind, that you can bring to mind. I'm working on a thesis called. Okay, now we're gonna decide how many pages it is. And this is, we don't want to have just like write until you're done. That's ridiculous. It doesn't happen any other time in your academic career. It's stupid. So, the way to find out how many pages something can be is to look at how long have they been in your department. What's the shortest dissertation or thesis that's happened? It has to be at least that many pages. So just make a decision. How many pages do you want your dissertation or thesis to be?
Can it be a range?
No.
Okay.
It has to be a page number.
But as you know, the sociology department says 75, I think, to 125 pages.
For an MA thesis? Yep.
Yeah.
So make a decision how long you want yours to be in there.
Can I get really hung up on this? So we set this page limit and then we surpass it? Or is that no, like we cannot surpass it?
You can surpass it, but we want you to have a page number that you are aiming for.
Okay.
Are you writing a dissertation?
Yeah.
How many pages is it going to be?
I wrote 375.
That is too long.
Oh, no.
Okay, thank goodness.
I think yours could be.
What?
That's not the minimum.
Seriously?
No.
Oh, I'm missing.
Yeah, 300 pages is not a minimum number of pages for a dissertation. I think your dissertation could be 307 pages. How long is yours going to be, Christine?
300.
300?
300, yeah.
It's better to have it not be a round number.
250.
298? Sure, 298. Does anyone else need a number? Constantine, how long?
297.
297? Did you write that down?
I want the number to you right here. So.
Okay, did you write it down? Does everyone have a number written down?
Yes.
Okay. So then, how many chapters are you going to include? All right, so chapters usually are not going to be shorter than 20 pages, right? They're usually going to be between 25 and 40 pages. 35 pages is a nice number for a chapter. So how many chapters are you going to have given the number of pages you have written down?
Are you talking about dissertation?
And theses.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So what does that mean about a thesis, if a thesis is going to be about 100 pages? Or how long is yours going to be?
76.
So how many chapters can you have in a 76-page thesis?
I'm shooting for 3.
How many pages are each of your chapters going
to
be?
I have 20 to 25.
Do you think that's a reasonable amount of pages, given what you write, how you write?
Yeah, I do.
Okay, good. Yeah. So how long, what department are you in?
Anthropology.
So usually, how long are undergrad theses in anthropology?
It's like 35, 45.
So how, you might not have chapters then,
yeah.
Right? You might have sections. So you can be doing sections.
Oh, I have questions.
Okay. So the last two things that I'm just going to say to do later are to formulate this not as an outline, but as a table of contents. So you take the number of chapters that you have, you decide provisionally what they're about, right? And write up a table of contents. So a table of contents is different than an outline because it's like a map, not a plan. So it's psychically different. And then the next thing is, you can very early, wherever you are in the stage, put the thing in the formatting guidelines that the institution actually requires you to use. So you're using the framework that the institution is actually setting out for you. And this is important because even now that most things are submitted electronically, they have a guideline that is like the margins are really big. So
on one side.
You, what?
On one side, the left side.
Yeah. So it's useful to know, like, how many pages is this actually going to be, right? And usually it's, usually you don't write as much for a thesis as you think you will because of the margins. So the other reason to put the manuscript in whatever formatting guidelines you're going to actually use is that formatting can take a lot of time. And if you leave this till the very end, you don't think this now because you're, like, far away from submitting, except for the person who's left to go work on his thesis. But it can be hours and hours and hours of really stressful, fidgety work. So you want to have a clear sense that you know like what format the bibliography has to be in, and that you can, you know, easily switch that around if you need to. So maybe you're using something like Zotero that allows you to swap formatting, you know, for the and then to track citations. So just right away start doing all of that. So when we're thinking about the kind of realities of this, just a few points. One is that I really am a fan of materializing the thing. So now that you know how many pages you're going to have, you could actually have a binder that is that many pages. And every time you finish a chapter, you can put the finished chapter in the place of the blank pages. What this does is that every time you're actually doing something, you're making the thing really exist. And this changes somehow. It's different than the phenomenology of just a continually receding screen where you can just highlight everything and delete it in a moment of, you know, self-hatred. So having a binder is very good. Having an automatic backup system is very good. So if you're using something like Dropbox, you need to be aware that they're not great on security. So if you have like, you know, populations at risk, you want to make sure that the codes for who everyone is offline, right? Like on a piece of paper, backed up somewhere. But that you have every file that you're currently working on always backed up automatically, so that that's not something you need to think about. So who right now, if their computer just died, would totally be okay? Excellent. So everyone who's not raising your hand, just do that tonight. Like, have an off-site backup that's continuously going so that you don't ever lose more than 15 minutes of work. So it's also good to develop a system for knowing when you've responded to comments. And I think that this can be a physical box. It can be a file where you say comments responded to, but some way that you can track when you've received feedback, you've processed it, and you're done with it. It's also good, because this process can take a long time, for you to have a box that is your archive box. So this could be if your supervisor makes physical comments on a piece of paper, or you've printed out things, or you have, you know, notes and stuff. You just keep all of that for the duration, because it almost always happens that at some point you want to go back to an earlier version, or there's a set of notes that you took at a conference or something that now you really, really want. And if you don't have a place where you're like, this is my archive for this dissertation or this thesis, you scramble then to find it. So just have a place where you can just put all of that stuff. And after you submit the dissertation or the thesis, you can go through that and get rid of it. Okay. So there's a couple of other things that I'd like to say ideally, but we're coming to the very end. And so I just want to talk about the question of stopping. So I've mostly been talking in a way that means that we want to not experience procrastination, or we want to work strategically in order to not be procrastinating. But there are times when procrastination is actually telling us something useful, and we need to have a sort of better attunement to when that is. So when we're having a block with our writing because actually we're taking on more than is possible to do, or there is something that we need to do more research into. So as you get a little bit, as you sort of quiet the clamor of neurosis around your writing, the voices that are saying, actually, this is something that needs to be related to can sound a little bit more clearly. So start asking yourself that question, like, is this procrastination just that I don't want to do this? Or is it actually something that I need to do more work on? Is the procrastination telling me that I'm really tired and I need to stop working for now? Right? So what is it actually saying? So I have one friend who has a little toy dinosaur, and it works for him to ventriloquize what the dinosaur is, the dissertation. The dinosaur can talk to him about what it needs. So whatever works for you, you know, that's a good thing. And then once you've developed this capacity, this habit of writing the memo, you're developing ways to have clear goals for yourself and for the people that you're working with. And once you have clear goals, it's much easier to ask, is this piece of writing meeting this goal? And then it's much easier to ask, has this piece of writing met this goal well enough that now I can stop? So recognizing that we can always make things more beautiful, right? There's going to be a point at which we're just able to stop. So the model here is Donald Winnicott, who was a psychologist, who said, we don't need to all be the best possible mother to our children, right? The mother that like sends them off and they're the perfect, ideal person. That's actually too much pressure to put on a parent. All we need to do is be a good enough mother. We just need to be a mother that allows the child to form their sense of self in such a way that they're able to get on in the world and make of themselves what they're going to make of themselves. So in the same way, we only have to be a good enough mother to our thesis. We don't have to be the ideal, best thesis writer. We just have to be a good enough mother, right? So then the thesis can just go on and do what it needs to do, which is be a credential that showed that you did the thing. That's all it has to do. There might be lots of other things that you do with your work. This comes back to that piece of recognizing that the writing is not everything that you are and that you're going to do, right? So that you're just trying to accomplish this much more limited thing, which is to finish a thesis. So this comes back to that question of, in this piece of writing, I hope to show. So having those kinds of clear goals let you decide when you've met them well enough to let it go. So I think that we're going to let this be a sort of good enough workshop. There are things that usually I get to spend more time in that somehow we didn't do. But then we come to this little piece of picture of the kid. So thank you so much, and I really think, you know, it's good to have this feeling of care for yourselves and for your writing and a sense of trust that you can do it, and I feel like that's something that's true. You can do it, and you will. It'll be good. So thank you.